Yeah. Let's make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Speak responsibly, Psalm 96. O sing to the Lord a new song.
Sing to the Lord all the earth.
Sing to the Lord, bless his name.
Tell his salvation from day to day.
Declare his glory among the nations.
His marvelous works among all the peoples.
For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised.
He is to be feared above all gods.
For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols.
But the Lord may make their enemies.
Splendor and majesty are before him.
Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples.
Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name.
Bring an offering and come into his courts.
Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness.
Tremble before him all the earth.
Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved.
He will judge the peoples with equity.
For he comes to judge the earth.
He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Merciful God and Father, graciously look upon the family of Tammy. Remember us all in our sorrow and grief. Support us when we are unable to understand the things that happen to us and those we love. Teach us all to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Grant that through your merciful help, we may have courage to face the days ahead, and when our last hour comes, be with us and grant us a blessed end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our first reading, recorded in the book of Acts, the 17th chapter. Now while Paul was waiting for Silas and Timothy at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him as he saw that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons, and in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. Some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers also conversed with him. And some said, "What does this babbler wish to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities, because he was preaching Jesus in the resurrection." They took hold of him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, "We know that this new teaching, we want to know what this new teaching is you are presenting. For you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." Now all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there would spend their time in nothing except telling or hearing something new. So Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life, breath, and everything. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God in the hope that they might feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from each of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, even as some of your own poets have said, for we are indeed his offspring. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of man. The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed the day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked. But others said, we will hear you again about this. So Paul went out from their midst. But some men joined him and believed, among whom were also Dionysius the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle was recorded in St. Peter's first letter, the second and third chapters. Put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up to salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. As you come to him, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious, you yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, the cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. So the honor is for you who believe. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, putting to death in the flesh, but being made alive in the spirit. in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey, when God's patience waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, 8 persons, were brought safely through water. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers having been subjected to him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel is recorded in the Gospel of St. John, the 4th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the 6th hour. There came a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty forever. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Continue with the hymn of the day.
Praise Thou and eternal glory.
Beloved, grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Word of God chosen for today comes from the gospel reading read just a few moments ago, but especially for Jesus says to the woman from Samaria, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty forever. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." So far our text. In the name of Jesus, amen. Last week, in the span of about 36 hours, received notification of two deaths. The second one being Tammy's. Being told roughly 1 hour before our Thanksgiving Day service at church began. The anticipation of having the blessed opportunity to be once again with my family at church, to be in Christ's presence and to hear the traditional gospel text that day of the healing of the 10 lepers, that excitement inside of me was growing and building. But as I received that phone call, that anticipation quickly faded away. In fact, it was replaced by a deep and sinking feeling in the pit of my stomach after I heard Tammy's sudden passing. I could not think of my own family nor my church family at the moment. I was only thinking of a grieving family in the emergency room. A similar feeling, no doubt, was experienced, I'm sure, by many of you who probably on Thanksgiving Day received the same news. That is not what we expect to hear on a national day of Thanksgiving. As I shared with the family before the service this afternoon, I was originally thinking of preaching on Psalm 118, verse 1. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Indeed, God's mercy and steadfast love does endure forever. He is good, and it is right for us to give him thanks and praise, even under circumstances such as this. But oftentimes, we are not like the Samaritan leper who was healed, who goes after finding out that he has been restored completely to return and give thanks to Christ for all that he had done for him. More often we are like the nine, who run off into the world and seek to find a peace that the world tries to give, but is wholly incapable of doing so. There's an even greater danger. The danger of grasping to a false sense of hope, a false sense of comfort, thinking that we can find true and lasting peace and consolation in the time of death by confessing just any God, or acknowledging just a supreme being of our own choosing. Doing so puts Christ upon the mantle with every other pagan deity, asserting that Jesus is just one God among many. God's word speaks in opposition to such a belief. Speaking through the prophet Isaiah, the only true and living God says this: I am the Lord, that is my name, my glory I give to no other, nor my praise to carved idols. Jesus, the only begotten Son of God, also says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. On Thanksgiving morning, the message was based on the text of the 10 lepers, traditionally. But I opted to preach on a much different text, an unexpected text. The fourth petition of the Lord's Prayer. Give us this day our daily bread. Why? Because we as God's people give thanks to God for all that he gives to us to support our body and life. It was the same God who supported Tammy's life. We heard on that day of how we as people depend on and lean upon two staples to support our life: bread and water. These things everybody needs. But what we need as Christians and as God's people is not earthly bread and earthly water, but the living bread come down from heaven, the living water which Christ himself provides. In the gospel that we heard from St. John, we learn that this Samaritan woman comes and encounters Jesus at a well. She comes and is asking about this living water that Jesus says that he could give, the water that he gives that nobody will be ever thirsty again. The water that I will give him, Jesus says, will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. But this world in which we live has to provide is nothing more than a dry well. In fact, it is nothing more than an empty wishing well into which people throw their money at and hope that it brings them some sort of consolation and peace. If you don't believe me, I went to the store on Thanksgiving Day afternoon. People were waiting to get stuff, thinking that would make them happy. That's not the case. The only true peace and the only comfort that we can find, especially at times like this, is that peace which our Lord Jesus Christ gives to us. His peace is much different. He says so. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives, do I give to you. You see, Christ's peace is one that surpasses all human understanding, as St. Paul says. And it is that peace which we need today. This world has nothing to offer you when it comes to your salvation. The world and our sinful flesh are means by which the devil lures us into a false sense of security for our salvation. Because the devil is constantly and feverishly going about spreading lies, wanting you to think that Christ didn't actually come to redeem you from all of your sins. But it is impossible for you to be released from the bondage of sin and slavery to sin, even causing us to doubt that Christ is the victor over death and the grave. The devil would much rather have you believe that being a good, outstanding, upright, moral person in society, that is the key to the pathway to heaven. Again, this is nothing but a lie. Because it undermines the faith which confesses Jesus Christ to be Lord and Savior. Through the living waters of holy baptism, Christ claims us as his own. He did so to Tammy as well, claiming her as one redeemed by Christ the crucified. Spiritually speaking, the well of the world is polluted by false teaching about who Christ is and why he comes in the first place. In fact, that well was poisoned by the devil's lies. But thanks be to God who gives us a living faith that clings to the crucified and risen Christ, the Christ which Paul preached in the Areopagus. Some mocked and scoffed at his teaching of the resurrection. That same mocking also happens today too. But it is the resurrection that gives us hope, even in the face of death. The Apostle Peter writes in his first letter, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." As Christians, and especially we as Lutherans, we understand baptism to be more than water from a well. It is powerful and it does great things. In the Lutheran faith, which Tammy once received, we are taught how water does such great things. Certainly not just water alone, but the Word of God in and with the water does these things. Along with the faith which trusts this word of God in the water. For without God's word, the water is plain water and no baptism. But with the word of God, it is baptism. That is, a life-giving water, rich in grace and the washing of the new birth in the Holy Spirit. As St. Paul says in Titus chapter 3, God saved us not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. We need the staples of life, yes. But as Christians, we need the staples that Christ alone can give. His body, his blood, his life. It is my prayer for each and every one of you here today, and especially to you as Tammy's family, that you come receive that water which Christ our dear Lord gives, that from it may spring up into a well that leads to eternal life. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guard and keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord, and life and laughter. Amen. Join in the prayer of the church. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and so pass with him through the gate of death and the grave to our joyful resurrection. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
Give to the family of Tammy and all who mourn comfort in their grief and assure confidence in your loving care. That casting all of their sorrow upon you, they may know the consolation of your love. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
Give courage and faith to the bereaved, that within the communion of your church they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the assurance of a holy and certain hope and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love who have departed in the faith. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and find comfort in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
O God of grace, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to life. We give you thanks that by his death he destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Strengthen us in the confidence that because he lives, we shall live also. That neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And taught by our Lord and trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. We close our time together singing Proskuneo.